In the early 1880s, faced with an Islamic nationalist revolt by the Mahdi, the Egyptians appealed to the British to help restore their authority in Sudan. British Prime Minister William Gladstone opposed getting sucked into a costly war and persuaded the Egyptian Khedive to accept limited British help to evacuate Sudan instead. General Charles Gordon, whom the Egyptians had previously employed as their governor in the country, was sent to oversee the evacuation of Egyptians from the Sudanese capital, Khartoum. Having got most of the Egyptian civilians out of the city, Gordon took it upon himself to defend Khartoum and seek to establish an alternative Sudanese regime to counter the Mahdi. But instead, by the end of March 1884, he found himself besieged in the city and desperately appealed to the British government for assistance. This is the story of the British Nile Expedition to rescue Gordon of Khartoum. The press in Britain led a clamour to send British troops to Sudan to rescue their popular hero, Chinese Gordon. Prime Minister Gladstone stalled. This was exactly the sort of military intervention that he had been opposed to in the first place. Nevertheless, in July 1884, having lost a vote in his cabinet, Gladstone agreed to send a relief column to Egypt, under the command of General Sir Garnet Wolseley. With contradictory messages coming out of Khartoum, Wolseley was told to stand his ground in Egypt until further notice. But as the year wore on, the Mahdi's stranglehold on Khartoum got tighter, and Gordon's messages became more desperate. Finally, on the 25th of September, nearly 5 months after the siege started, London ordered Wolseley to march on the Sudanese capital. There were two possible routes for Wolseley to reach Khartoum. The shortest was from Suakin on the Red Sea coast, through the desert to Berber on the Nile, and then an advance up the river to the besieged Gordon. The other way was to march up the Nile all the way from Egypt. Whilst four times longer, it did have the advantage of a continuous supply of water for his 5,000-strong army. The British general went for this second option, and the Nile Expedition, or the Gordon Relief Expedition, was born. Based upon his experiences during the Red River campaign in Canada, Wolseley saw the Nile not just as a water supply, but as a transport route. His army wouldn't march to Khartoum. All 5,000 of them would take boats. The only problem, apart from the distance, was that his boats would have to manage their way through a series of rapids on the river. Not that this daunted Wolseley. He had a plan. Back in Canada, he had used voyageurs, a skilled local boatman, to get his boats through similar obstacles. All he needed was those same men to cross the Atlantic and use their skills on the Nile. After a two-month delay, 380 Canadian voyageurs arrived in Wolseley's camp in Egypt. Not bad timing, but that two-month delay would come home to roost, as you're going to discover later. Wolseley was joined on this campaign by his fabled Ashanti ring of officers, whom he had worked closely with in the past. Redvers Buller, Major Generals William Butler and Henry Brackenbury, Sir Evelyn Wood, and Sir Herbert Stewart. The general was doing his best to keep in touch with Gordon in Khartoum via a series of Arab riders recruited and operating under the command of a young and promising officer, Major Herbert Kitchener. On the 17th of November, Kitchener brought a message from Gordon. Dated the 4th of November, it stated that Khartoum only had enough food to hold out for another 40 days. At the pace of his Nile expedition, even with the Canadian boatman, there was no way that Wolseley could reach him by the end of December. He needed a plan B. And being Sir Garnet Wolseley, he had one. He would send a flying column of about 1,500 men, mainly mounted on camels, on a shortcut across the desert to arrive far up the river at Matima. There it would wait for the main river column under Major General William Earle. Wolseley calculated that just their very presence that far up the Nile would rattle the resolve of the Mahdi. Indeed, he privately thought that the Mahdi would panic and lift the siege long before the British reached Khartoum. And then Wolseley could meet Gordon on the banks of the Nile, yet another glory in his glittering career. Whilst the desert column was waiting for General Earle's force to join them, Wolseley's Chief of Intelligence, Colonel Charles Wilson, would take a boat up the Nile to conduct a reconnaissance of Khartoum and check on Gordon. he would be accompanied by a small detachment of British redcoats to give hearts to the defenders and provide advance warning to the Mahdists that the British army was on its way. Wilson was given strict orders by Wolsey to neither evacuate Gordon nor to let his redcoats disembark. The flying column racing across the desert was to be commanded by Sir Herbert Stewart, one of Wolsey's Ashanti ring. Second in command would be Colonel Fred Burnaby, a former household cavalry officer and adventurer who had volunteered his services to Wolsey. Third in command was the intelligence chief and Kitchener's commander, Colonel Wilson. A talented cartographer, Wilson had been commissioned in the Royal Engineers in 1855. As a thinking soldier, he was not someone who Wolsey trusted. The general much preferred soldiers with brawn, not brains, men like Buller and Burnaby. But as he was the next senior officer attached to the Desert Column, Wolsey really had no other choice. Despite being called a flying column, Stuart's progress across the desert was hampered by a lack of camels. This slow progress enabled the Mahdi to assemble 15,000 warriors at Abu Klea to block their advance. The ensuing Battle of Abu Klea, fought on the 17th of January 1885, has been covered in another recent story, so I won't go into the details, but share just the headlines. A ferocious Mahdist attack actually managed to get inside the British square after it had been opened to let the naval brigade under Captain Sir Charles Beresford run out their garden and machine gun. In bitter hand-to-hand fighting, the British managed to drive them out, but not before 65 of their number had been killed, including the second-in-command, Colonel Fred Burnaby. In the end, the Mahdists lost nearly 1,500 men dead, and the British had achieved a tactical victory. However, Stuart still hadn't reached his goal of the River Nile. 2 days later, and still marching towards the Nile, breathless scouts galloped up to Stuart and reported that the Mahdist army of 13,000 to 14,000 men had reassembled and was blocking the route at Abu Kru. It says something about their tenacity and belief in their cause that having lost 1,500 of their comrades 2 days before, the Mahdists were still very much up for the fight. Stuart instructed his column to build a zareba, or fortified position, on a nearby knoll, using biscuit boxes, camel saddles, and any other paraphernalia they could find. This move was conducted whilst under incessant fire from Mahdist sharpshooters located in scrubland just 300 yards away. Half an hour later, Sir Herbert instructed Major Rhodes to tell the men to have a hasty breakfast whilst dodging the constant stream of Mahdist bullets hitting the zareba. 44-year-old Major Frank Rhodes from the 1st Royal Dragoons was the older brother of mining magnate and imperialist Cecil Rhodes. Later in life, he was involved in the Jameson raid in South Africa. Having issued Rhodes with his orders, Stuart walked away. He'd gone 12 yards when he dropped quietly to the floor, blood pumping from his stomach. Wolsey's trusted subordinate had been mortally wounded. With the commander of the Desert Column dying and number 2, Colonel Burnaby, killed at Abu Klea, command now passed to the chief intelligence officer, Colonel Charles Wilson. Wilson, a man with no combat experience, took charge as 13,000 to 14,000 Mahdists prepared to attack the tiny British force. If you're enjoying this story, then please give me a like using the icon below. He had two choices: wait for the attack on the zareba in the hot sun, or advance on the river. He decided to advance, tackle the Mahdist army, and reach the waters of the Nile. Just as at Abu Klea, the British would form a moving square. The mounted infantry on foot would hold the front and side left. The dismounted guards would do likewise on the right. And the Royal Sussex Regiment, together with some of the Heavy Camel Regiment, again dismounted, would form the rear. The rest of the column would remain in the zareba. Unlike at Abu Klea, the camels would also be left in the zareba. And thus, Wilson's square, whilst numerically smaller than the last battle, was far more compact. They had covered just over a mile when they came face to face with the whole Mahdist army. If the Mahdists were fazed following their losses at Abu Klea, they didn't show it. Fired up with religious fervour and pride, they charged. The British volley fire seemed to make no impact on their charge whatsoever. They just kept coming. Wilson was not a brawn soldier. He was a thinking soldier. And recalling this very same situation at Abu Klea just days before, He remembered how the Mahdist advance was only checked 200 to 300 yards from the square. And so he took an incredible risk. He ordered his bugler to sound the ceasefire. All around the British square, the Martini Henry rifles fell silent. Can you imagine being one of those ordinary soldiers, watching thousands of Mahdists running towards you and just standing there, and knowing that the man who's just ordered you to stop firing was a cartographer who had never been in action? What would be going through your mind? The Sudanese Mahdists were now just 500 yards away and coming on like a steam train. 400 yards, 300 yards. And then the bugle sounded, continuous fire. At that range and that rapidity of fire, the Mahdists entered a death zone. The volley fire from the square was joined by guns from the Royal Artillery firing from the zareba. Very few Mahdists came closer than 200 yards. They looked for a chink in the square, but Wilson had kept it tight. This was not their day. There would be no breaking into the British square. And so they retreated, leaving 300 of their comrades dead on the battlefield, and countless more wounded. It was another sobering victory for the British. They had suffered 121 casualties that morning, almost all from sniper fire. Amongst them was Major General Sir Herbert Stewart, who died of his wounds shortly afterwards. By nightfall, the British finally reached the River Nile. 2 days after the Battle of Abu Klea, on the 21st of January, they sighted four steamers that had been sent downriver from Khartoum by Gordon. They had been sailing backwards and forwards for the last couple of weeks, waiting Wolseley's relief expedition. Wilson was handed a note written by Gordon, dated the 29th of December, which briefly stated, "Khartoum all right, can hold out for years." This upbeat message from the beleaguered Gordon seemed to be at odds with the captain of one of the steamers, who reported that the food supplies were almost gone when they had left the city 2 weeks ago, bearing that note. It was also at odds with Gordon's journals, which had been sent with the steamers. In his last entry, dated the 14th of December, Gordon bluntly wrote, "Now mark this. If the expeditionary force, and I ask for no more than 200 men, does not come in 10 days, the town may fall." Wilson was perplexed. Not only did Gordon's optimistic message dated the 29th of December contradict his sombre journal entry dated 2 weeks beforehand, but Wilson's orders from Wolseley were that he was to proceed to Khartoum with just 20 men from the Royal Sussex Regiment, not the 200 requested by Gordon. Wilson dearly wished that he could telegraph Wolseley, but there was no telegraph. Once more, Wilson would have to make his own decision and live with the consequences. He swiftly came to the conclusion that as Wolseley, not Gordon, was his commanding officer, he would make his reconnaissance trip to Khartoum to ascertain the situation, accompanied by just the 24 men from the Royal Sussex Regiment. He also decided that his primary duty was to protect the Desert Column from further attack, and spent the next 3 days overseeing the construction of a fortified encampment alongside the Nile, and scouting the river in the steamships to spy any advancing Mahdist forces. Those 3 days would also allow his men to collect firewood to power two steamships to carry Wilson, his redcoats, and about 100 Sudanese troops loyal to Gordon, all the way to Khartoum and back. Satisfied that the column was well protected and not about to be attacked, Wilson set off on the 24th of January. As per his orders, he was accompanied by 22 men of the Royal Sussex Regiment under the command of Major Lionel Trafford. The men had deliberately swapped their khaki fatigues for traditional red tunics in an effort to both encourage the defenders and serve as a warning to the Mahdist besiegers. If the red tunics were meant to ward off the Mahdi, they didn't. In fact, they might have inadvertently had the opposite effect. When messages reached the Mahdi about the defeat at Abu Klea, he was disconcerted. Initially, it sounded like Wolseley's army was closing in, and the Mahdi considered retreating to the vast hinterland of Sudan, just as Wolseley had calculated. However, the reality was that the only British army coming to Khartoum were 24 men on two steamers. His confidence restored, but aware it was only a matter of time before Wolseley did arrive, the Mahdi decided to storm the town immediately. Before I continue with the attack on Khartoum, if you're enjoying this story, then please subscribe to my channel so you don't miss any future videos here on YouTube. In the early hours of the 26th of January 1885, his forces launched an all-out attack on Khartoum. The falling waters of the Nile had created a gap between Gordon's defences and the river. And it was through this that the Mahdi's warriors entered the town, bypassing the weak and starving defenders. Once in the town, the Mahdists went on a terrifying killing spree. Of the 30,000 civilians and 6,000 soldiers in Khartoum, it was estimated that anywhere between 4 and 10,000 were butchered. Wives and daughters were distributed as slaves to the Mahdi's men. And what became of Gordon himself? The traditional story is that the Mahdists stormed the governor's palace, where he faced them down at the top of the staircase. Almost Christ-like, he offered no resistance as he was struck down. This scene was famously depicted by Charlton Heston in the film Khartoum. It was a story picked up by Victorian painters. A masculine Christian martyr sacrificing himself to the baying forces of Islam. This sort of martyrdom was a common theme in paintings of the period. The Last Man to Die at Isandhwana and The Last Stand of the Shangani Patrol represent similar storylines. But it was not the only account of how he died. His Sudanese ADC claimed that he and Gordon actually fought the Mahdists with revolvers and swords until Gordon was speared. Knocked unconscious, when the Sudanese aide came round, he saw Gordon's dead body lying nearby, minus his head. Another account tells of Gordon being killed in the street whilst fighting his way towards the Austrian consulate. However he met his death, his severed head was presented to the Mahdi, who put it on public display. As for his body, no one knows, but it was probably tossed in the Nile. 2 days later, Wilson's flotilla came in sight of the city. Through his binoculars, Wilson was concerned that the Egyptian flag was not flying above the governor's palace. As they closed in on Khartoum, they came under heavy fire from modern Krupp's artillery pieces and hundreds of Mahdists lining the banks. It was blatantly apparent that the town had fallen. Whether Gordon or any of the defenders were still holed up was hard for Wilson to say. His orders had been to make a reconnaissance trip, and having seen enough, he ordered the captain to turn round and get out fast. On the return journey, both steamers foundered on submerged rocks in the river. Having swum and waded ashore, many of the Sudanese crew and soldiers silently slipped away to join the Mahdi. A junior officer from the King's Royal Rifle Corps, Eddie Stuart Wolseley, was now tasked with taking a small rowing boat downriver to fetch help. In the dark of the night, Stuart Wolseley and a small group of men from the Royal Sussex rowed past the Mahdist garrison at Wadi Habeshi. With the Mahdist sentries sitting beside their campfires on the shore, Stuart Wolseley ordered his men to be as silent as possible. In the pitch black, they started to pass the settlement. But then the moon came out from behind a cloud, illuminating their tiny boat in the middle of the river. The Mahdists leapt to their feet and opened fire. With their cover blown, Stuart Wolseley roared at his men to row as fast as they could, and somehow they managed to get past unscathed. The next few days must have been a nerve-jangling wait from Wilson and his men, stranded deep in hostile territory. It was only a matter of time before they were discovered and either killed or captured. They didn't even know Stuart Wolseley had managed to make it through. Then on the 3rd of February, they heard the sounds of gunfire and shelling downriver at Wadi Habeshi. Hurrying along the bank, they saw a steamer from their main camp firing on the Mahdist garrison. Captain Sir Charles Beresford, the Royal Naval officer who had won fame for his heroism at the bombardment of Alexandria 4 years earlier, and whose Gardner gun had jammed at Abu Klea, had come to their rescue. The swashbuckling, ambitious and aggressive Beresford had sailed past the Wadi Habeshi garrison at full speed, taking them by surprise. Wilson and his men, however, were far from safe. As he watched, he saw the Mahdists firing back with their own guns, and suddenly one of their shells hit the steamer's boiler. Losing power, she drifted midstream as jubilant Mahdists now rained fire down on the stricken vessel. In a bizarre turn of events, Wilson was now to come to Beresford's rescue. When his steamer had been wrecked, Wilson had brought the ship's mountain gun ashore. And now he led the men of the Royal Sussex Regiment, together with that gun, to support the helpless Beresford. With Wilson's covering fire, Beresford was able to organise a repair to the boiler and then pick up the men from the riverbank. When safely back at camp, Colonel Wilson sent an urgent message to Wolseley, telling him the shocking news from Khartoum. The news hit Wolsey like a sledgehammer. Gordon was his only living hero. He'd seen the rescue as a sacred mission, as well as the crowning glory to his own career. He sent a telegram to London. The news of the fall of Khartoum arrived in Britain on the 5th of February, swiftly followed by the confirmation of Gordon's death. The nation was shocked. Chinese Gordon was a national hero. It was inconceivable that he was dead. It was also inconceivable that the British Army, led by her most able general, had not rescued him. The recrimination started, and scapegoats were searched for. As far as Wolsey was concerned, only one man was to blame. Wilson. In the general's mind, Wilson had been too slow in his journey to Khartoum. If he'd set out on the day the steamers had arrived, on the 21st, then he would have been in Khartoum on the 25th, the day before the Mahdi's attack. And in that respect, he was right. What Wolsey didn't take account of was that the collection of firewood for the journey would have taken at least 24 hours, meaning that Wilson would have arrived on the 26th, hours after the storming of Khartoum. Wolsey's cry of too late was taken up by the British press. Prime Minister Gladstone, the man always against military involvement in Sudan, now did a U-turn and ordered Wolsey to advance on Khartoum to teach the Mahdi a lesson. But with the Sudanese summer nearing, Wolsey suggested waiting until the autumn, especially as there was no longer an imperative to rush to the city to rescue Gordon. But events far away would put pay to the invasion to avenge Gordon. An incident involving Russian soldiers in Afghanistan suddenly diverted British attention away from a pointless, punitive expedition against the Mahdi and towards defending the jewel in Britain's imperial crown, India. War with Russia never came, but once the scare had blown over, no one in Britain really cared about Sudan anymore. It was all too late, for Gordon and for the people of Khartoum. Wolsey's force quietly retreated. But if anyone was too late, it could be argued it was Wolsey himself. By not ordering the flying column to fly earlier in December and not providing enough camels, he had denied Stuart both the element of surprise and forced him to fight two battles, all of which cost valuable time. And whilst we're on the subject of delays, Wolsey's insistence on transporting the rivermen all the way from Canada wasted a lot more time than Wilson patrolling the River Nile. Even if Wilson had reached Gordon the day before the assault on Khartoum, what would he have achieved? It was the threat of Wolsey's advance that, far from forcing the Mahdi to retreat, had actually spurred him to attack the city. And it was highly unlikely that a man driven by intense religious zeal would have been cowed by 22 redcoats. Seeing as Wolsey's orders were that those redcoats were not to disembark and he wasn't to evacuate Gordon, it's hard to see how they would have had any effect on the outcome, even if they had arrived on the 25th. It could be argued that Wolsey had seriously misjudged and underestimated the Mahdi. And yet, the British public did not blame Wolsey, nor did they blame Wilson. Following the lead from the Queen, they rounded on Prime Minister Gladstone. The Queen sent a telegram, not in cipher, to senior government ministers, blaming the Prime Minister, whom she disliked intensely, for the debacle. He should have sent Wolsey sooner. And as no doubt intended, the open communication was seen by the press, who rounded on the Prime Minister. Gladstone, who'd been known as GOM, the grand old man, now became MOG, the murderer of Gordon. And he was to fall from office that year. Colonel Charles Wilson, the man who was too late to Khartoum, but who had won a victory at Abu Klea in his first ever battle, never did command in the field again. He returned to his true skill set, cartography, and he became Director General of the Ordnance Survey. He died in 1905. Whilst Wolsey was to go on to become a Field Marshal and ultimately Commander-in-Chief of the British Army, he, like Wilson, would never lead a military campaign again. The Nile Expedition was the last time Wolsey's fabled Ashanti Ring came together. Rather like their leader, none of them had come away from Sudan with an enhanced reputation. Stuart was dead, and Sir Evelyn Wood put into a series of desk jobs back in Britain. Buller would take command of the British Army in South Africa during the Boer War, presiding over the calamitous results of Black Week. In June 1885, Prime Minister Gladstone was forced from office to be replaced by a Conservative administration led by Lord Salisbury. Less than 2 weeks after Gladstone's downfall, the Mahdi died of typhus. He was 41. His second in command, the Khalifa, continued his work and established an independent Islamic state based upon Sharia law that lasted for well over a decade. His attempts to spread the Mahdi's Islamic revolution brought Sudan into conflict with Abyssinia and Egypt, where his invading army would be defeated by an Anglo-Egyptian force at the Battle of Toski. It was over a decade before the British returned to Sudan to avenge Gordon and the failure of the Nile Expedition to rescue him. When they did, they were to be commanded by Wilson's young intelligence officer who had ferried messages to and from his hero, Gordon, in Khartoum. By then, young Herbert Kitchener was a general himself, and he would avenge his hero's death by defeating the Khalifa at the Battle of Omdurman. Thanks for watching, and I hope you enjoyed that video. Watch out for my next one, all about the larger-than-life Victorian soldier and adventurer, Colonel Fred Burnaby, the man who some say was the character that George Fraser MacDonald used as his model, the Harry Flashman. Until then, thanks for your support, keep well, and I'll see you very soon.